with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
Come on, would you just lift your hands this morning and say that again with us?
Say, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
The splendor of a king is clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice.
He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great
stands,
and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son. He's the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how
Come on, just lift your hands and say it with us.
For the name above all names, and you're worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing, how great is our God.
See, how great
is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great
hallelujah.
Is our God.
Come on, just one more time with hands lifted high. Could you say that together? How great. Say,
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see
how great
is our God.
You're the name above
all names,
and you're worthy of
all praise.
Yes, you are.
And my heart will sing, how great is our God.
Amen. Yes, he's great. Come on and give him praise. Hallelujah. Come on, I just wonder, is anybody in love with Jesus this morning? Can you just lift your hands and can we just welcome him right in this place? Father, you are welcome here.
Of what they think you're like, but I heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased in that I'm never alone. You're good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, oh, 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 oh. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you can provide, 'cause you know just what we need, for we say you're good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, and you're good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Thank you.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
Come on.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are perfect
in all of your ways. To us.
Come on and say it again.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are perfect
in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Your good, good Father, it's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Your good, good Father. It's who you are.
It's who you are. It's who you are.
And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You are perfect.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Come on, lift your hands and tell him, Lord,
you are perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways.
Your good, good Father, it's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
Now come on, if you believe that, would you just lift your hands just as high as you can? And would you say this with us? You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Come on, just the voices.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect. In all of your ways,
you are
perfect in all of your ways to us.
And your good, good Father, it's who you are,
it's who you are,
it's who you are.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
Hallelujah. Come on and praise him. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Seeing your justice and your mercy, heaven walked the broken road, here to fight the sinner's battle, here to make my fall your own. To see your face is all my fears surrender. Hold my heart within
where burden turns to wonder.
And I will fight to follow. And I will fight for love. And throw my life forever to the triumph of the Son.
So let your love be my companion in the war against my pride. Yes. Long to break all vain obsession until you're all that I desire. It's all my fear surrendered.
Hold my heart.
Hold my heart within this grace where burden turns to wonder.
And I will fight to follow. Throw my life forever to the triumph of the Son.
And I know your love has won it all. You took the fall to embrace my sorrow. And I know you took the fight. You came and died, but the grave was borrowed. I know you stood again, so I can stand with a life to follow in the light of your
to see your face is all my fears surrendered.
Hold my heart within this grace where burden turns to wonder.
And I will find the grave was borrowed. I know you stood again, so I can stand with the light to follow in the light of your name.
And I know
your love has won it all. You took the fall to embrace.
face my sorrow, and I know you took the fight. You came and died, but the grave was borrowed. I know you stood again, so I can stand with a light to follow in the light of your name.
Come on and praise him together. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Do you love the Lord? Is he good? He's a good, good Father.
Amen. Yes, he is.
We are loved by him. That's who we are. That's our identity. Amen. Look at your neighbor. Just say, God loves me. Thank you, Jesus. That's who I am. Praise the Lord. I want to share with you today, right along those same lines, perfect songs for today's word. I want to talk about favor. Do you have the favor of the Lord on your life? Somebody needs to say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Favor. Thank you, Jesus. Can we go to the Lord in prayer? Then we're going to talk about favor. Father, we just come before you. You are good. And you've been so good to us. You are faithful. Even when we're not faithful, you're faithful. We're so thankful for your goodness, God. We're so thankful for your grace, Lord. God, and I'm thankful for your presence, your Holy Spirit that is here today in our hearts and with us, God. You are with us as we praise and worship you. And Lord, I just thank you for the word today that you've spoken into my life. Let me speak it, God, with boldness and authority. And let it come out in a way, God, that will minister to people, that will encourage somebody, lift somebody up. Let it be a word that transforms someone's life today, God. And I just speak against any kind of hindrance or distraction that would keep us from receiving it. And so by faith, God, I just declare your favor upon you. We preach the word of God, and everybody prayed and said amen with me. Say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Y'all come on in. Welcome. Psalm 5 and verse 12. The fifth psalm and verse 12. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor, you will surround him as with a shield. Let me read it again. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor, you will surround him as with a shield. Let me ask you a question. Are you the righteous? Come on, say yes, amen.
Yes, amen.
If you've given your heart to Jesus, you're the righteous. If you've believed on the Lord Jesus, you're the righteous. If you've trusted in him, you are the right. Did you listen last week? Did you listen to the word? Did you listen Wednesday about the flesh? When God gave us a new life, that new life is righteousness. He's given us his righteousness. What an awesome thing. And so because you're righteous, you are blessed. Because you are righteous, you are surrounded like a shield with the favor of the Lord. Proverbs 22 and 1 says, a good name is to be chosen rather than great riches. Loving favor rather than silver and gold. Hear me today. Favor from God is the best thing going. It's better than silver. It's better than gold. Favor from God is better than winning the lottery. Amen. I better get some amens there. Amen. It is. It is better. Favor is the best thing that you can have. And favor works through faith. Favor works through faith. It's one thing to have favor. It's another thing to know you have favor and believe in God's favor over your life. See, you can have all the favor in the world, but if you don't have faith to make it work, If you don't have faith to live it out, if you don't have faith to know that it's yours, then it won't do you any good. Did you know that there's enough grace right now, there's enough grace for everybody on the planet to be saved today? You believe that? That there's enough grace for every, I mean, into the prisons, into what, every, there's enough grace for every single person on the globe to be saved today. But you got to have faith, right? You got to, if everybody on the globe would put their faith in Jesus Christ, and He's got enough grace to save everybody. So favor needs faith. We are saved by grace, that's favor, through faith. And so what I want to do today is to get you to believe in the favor of God. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, without faith it is impossible to please Him. If we turn that around, then what we'd get is that with faith we can please God. With faith we can bring a smile to God's face. And you know what favor really is? Favor is God smiling down on you. Favor is the blessings of God on your life. And so if without faith it's impossible, then with faith we can please God. The Bible tells us that the elders obtained a good testimony because of their faith. They received favor because of their faith. Faith is a God pleaser. And anybody can have faith. Anybody. Young, old, man, or woman. No matter how dark or messed up your past is, you can have faith today. And you can receive favor from God's Word. Did you hear me? You can have faith today and receive. You can leave this place with the favor of God on your life. And my prayer is that you do. And my prayer is if you came in here with the favor of God and you didn't know it, then you'll leave here today knowing that you got it. Because that will make all the difference in the world. You can go through the Bible. Hebrews 11 is a great chapter. We don't have time to go through that. But you can look at all the heroes of the faith that obtained favor from God because of their faith. There's a teenage boy named David, and he received favor, and it was before he was ever called King David. It was before Samuel poured the oil on top of his head to anoint him. Now come on, David walked in favor before any of that. He had faith in God. David had faith to stand up against Goliath, right? He put his life on the line. He put his nation on the line, but he had faith to do it. And so he had favor in his life. He did that. There was a man named Noah. Y'all remember Noah? Hopefully. Noah spent over 100 years building a boat. A boat. Did you hear me? A boat. Over 100 years building a boat. The boat was so big, up until the 19th century, no one else had ever built a boat nearly that big. By the way, I don't know if y'all been watching, but there's actually an Ark Encounter opening up in July. Up in Kentucky, they've built the ark, the actual size, and got animals in it. And so, we need to go there. We need to take a church group there. Sounds like a very interesting thing. You can look it up online. It's called the Ark Encounter. But Noah built this boat on land. He didn't build it on a dock. Dennis, he didn't build it beside water. He built it on land. There's no water anywhere. And the Bible says that by building that ark, he was preaching righteousness. So every nail that he drove in, every board that he sawed on or sanded on, he was preaching to the world that God's judgment was coming. And you know what? Nobody was amening him or attaboy or you know. You know, come on, they're calling him crazy. They saying, you don't have any sense, Noah. But Noah had faith. And if you go back and read, God smiled down on Noah. When God looked at, the Bible says that God found, or Noah found grace, favor in the eyes of the Lord. It was appropriated through faith. It was brought to life through faith. There's a man named Gideon. Gideon had 300 men, and then there was thousands of Midianites. The Midianites had weapons. You know what Gideon had? He had trumpets, he had pitchers, he had candles, and he had favor. That's all he needed, was a favor from the Lord. We can go on down the line. There was Ruth. Ruth was from a pagan country. She became rich and blessed because she had favor. God put a man named Boaz in her life. Changed everything. You can go on and on. Listen, it doesn't matter how old or how young, you're a man, you're a woman, you got a really, really dark past. God says you can have favor. God says you can bring a smile to His face. You can bring joy to His heart to put your faith in Him and to trust Him. We could go on and on, but look, here's the thing. You got to believe. You got to believe what God has said. You can't go through every situation in your life doubting that God's going to do anything for you. You can't, every turn, every situation, everything that happens, you can't question God of why it didn't go the way you wanted it to go. And then wonder why nothing ever happens right in your life. You've got to get up and trust God and believe God. Even when it turns in a different way that you weren't expecting, you trust God. You believe God. You stick to it and you stand up and you'll see favor in your life. And everyone else will look at you and wonder how in the world you got so much favor. It's because you believe God. How many believes God today? Come on. Now, how many believes that you have the favor of God in your life? Now, you might raise your hand in church. Do you really believe it? Do you know that? And trust Him in every situation. Believe Him at every turn. When things don't go your way, bless Him. Praise Him. Oh, there was a woman, I forgot about this lady. There was a woman from Canaan. Those Canaanite people, man, they were wicked, idolatrous. They were bad people, bad people. This Canaanite woman came up to Jesus and said, "Jesus, I need you to heal my daughter." He ignored her, didn't even answer her. You know what she did? She began to worship Him. How many of us would do that? How many of us, when we don't feel like God's hearing what we're asking, don't feel like God's listening to what we're praying, yet we still come and we throw our hands up and we worship? You know what next happened? Next, He called her a dog. You know what she did? She called Him Master. Her faith was turned into favor. By the end of the story, her daughter was healed. Jesus smiled upon her. Jesus said, "You got great faith. Here's some favor." Are you hearing me today? Are you hearing me? Trust Him. Look at your neighbor and say, "I'm favored and I know it." Your life won't change. Y'all get your minds out of the gutter. Your life won't change until you know it. You got to know it. I heard the snickers. You got to know it. Who in here knows that you are blessed and highly favored? I'm getting tired of raising my hands. You're going to be real tired by the end of the day because I want you to know it. If you know you have God's favor in your life, then no matter what it looks like, you know in your heart that God is working behind the scenes. As a matter of fact, I declare over everyone here today that God is working behind the scenes on your behalf. You got favor and God's doing stuff. You don't even know He's doing it. This week, your boss met with somebody else and they talked about you and said, "We're going to give him a promotion. We've been watching." You don't even know it. You think God's not even listening, but God is working behind the scenes with favor on your behalf. Somebody say amen. Amen. Favor's working behind the scenes. And if you can get this, come on. You will work out of favor instead of for favor. Because I don't know about you, but I gotta be honest that I've had many times in my Christian life where I worked for favor instead of out of favor. I've had times where I worked in order to gain God's favor instead of knowing that I had God's favor and let work flow from that. See, we don't work for favor. Grace gives us favor. We have faith to believe it, and then work comes out of it. Did you hear me? That's how it happens. That's how it happens. Faith brings favor. It's possible you're living this hard, difficult, strenuous, straining, stressful life. And you've got God's favor, and you don't know it. Your efforts aren't producing what you're trying to make them to produce. You're favored and you don't even know it. You would live an entirely different way if you knew today with all your heart that God's favor was upon your life. We talked about Joseph on Friend Day. How God brought Joseph from the pit to the palace. Joseph was the second over all of Egypt, second only to Pharaoh. Because of that, his family had favor. They were blessed. There was about 70 of them or so. They would have died from the famine, but because Joseph had been promoted, you remember the story, they got to come and live there. And so they got to partake of the plenty because of that favor. Well, Joseph died. And when Joseph died, a time after that, a new Pharaoh rose up. And he didn't remember Joseph. He didn't know of Joseph. And so he didn't treat God's people the same way. Things begin to change. But here's something. Here's what you've got to know. They were still favored of God. They were still God's people. They were. And they multiplied. And our Hope Haven's going to remember some of this because we've been studying Exodus on Fridays. They were God's people. And they were still favored, even if they didn't know it. Guys, in 400 years, they multiplied like rabbits. I'm serious. They went from 70 to a few million. That's a lot of babies. That's a bunch. They multiplied. They had favor. They had the promises of God. But guess what? They didn't know it. They didn't know it. You know who? Do you know who did know it? Who knew it? God knew it. Who else knew it? Would you believe this? Their enemy knew it. Did you know that your enemy knows that you're favored even when you don't? Did you know that your enemy knows what you're capable of even when you don't? Most of us can get good right here. So Pharaoh, the enemy of God's people, he had a leader's meeting. And this is what they come to the conclusion. Exodus chapter 1. I'm going to read verse 9, verse 10, verse 14. And he said to his people, "Look, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we." Did y'all just hear that? Did you just hear what the enemy declared about God's people? Now, if you just step back and look, God's people are over there making bricks. They are slaves. They're in bondage. But the enemy knows that they're more and they're mightier. But they don't know it. He said, "Come, let us deal shrewdly with them." And they made their lives bitter. Listen to him. "With hard bondage, in mortar, in brick, and in all manner of service in the field, all their service in which they made them serve was with rigor." In other words, they had the possibility of favor. Favor was on their life. They could walk on it, but instead they lived in bondage. The enemy made their lives bitter. The enemy made their life difficult. The enemy knew what they was capable of, but he kept them pressed down. Somebody, you're here and you sort of know what you could be. God really knows what you could be. Even the enemy knows a little bit about what you could be, but he's keeping you pressed down and he's pushing you into a life of bitterness. You work hard with nothing to show for it. You try, but to no avail. But you're favored of God. And you're about to rise up. Amen? You're about to rise up. Things are about to change. Look at your neighbor and say, "Things are about to change." See, if we just forget about for a moment, what God knows about us. If we could just know what the devil knows about us. If we could just know that much, we'd be something. If we could just see the truth that greater is he that's in us. You'll think the devil knows that? Absolutely, he knows that. He knows that God is greater. He knows that you're a child of God. He knows that he can't touch you without God's sovereignty in that. He knows what he's incapable of, but he can lie. He can cause you to be heavy burden. He can discourage. He can speak things into your life. But man, if you're a child of God and you know it, and you got favor in life and you know it, then those things will not hinder you. The psalmist says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. What's he saying? He's saying, I am favored. I am favored. And when the devil is running rampant in my life, and it would appear that I'm living in the presence of my enemies, then I might as well just get ready to eat, because God's going to prepare a table before me right there in the middle of them, and Satan's going to have to watch me smack my lips or lick my lips, and he's going to watch me enjoy the blessings of God. I'm going to worship and praise and walk in joy and favor of the Lord, because I know who I am and I'm not listening to his lies. And I declare I'm coming out with more than I went in with. If I ended up in that place of hardship, that place of bondage, and I don't even know if it was all my fault or somebody else's fault or the devil made me do it or whatever, but I know I'm there. I declare in Jesus' name that I got favor on my life and I'm coming out with more than I went in with. Because that was what happened with God's people. 70 people came into Egypt poor. They didn't have any food. They came there so that they could live. But you know how they left Egypt? They left Egypt in Exodus chapter 12. We ain't even got to read it. Let me just tell you how they left Egypt. They left Egypt with necklaces and earrings and fancy clothes. Go back and read Exodus chapter 12 right there. The Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and they plundered them for their silver and their gold. In other words, they came out with more stuff than they came in with. Why? Favor. 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 Now it took them a while to realize it. Because when Moses first went in there, and the girls would remember this, when Moses first went in there and said, let my people go, Pharaoh said, you just go back to where you came from. I don't know who you are. I don't know who this God is you're talking about. Well, over the next few chapters, Pharaoh was going to learn who that God was that he was talking about. But first what happened is Pharaoh said, we're not having this. And he got together his supervisors, his taskmasters, and he said, go tell them they got to make the same amount of bricks, but they don't get straw now. They go find their own straw. But they got to make the same amount of bricks. And so the people of God who had favor, who were trying to stand up and trust and believe it, the enemy seemingly just squashed them and said, this ain't happening. He will fight you over that. The devil will fight you over it. You try to stand up and say you got favor, he will bluff you. He will try to make things worse in your life than they were before. But if you know you got favor, you just stand. You don't back down. You stand. Plague number one came. Plague number two. Plague number three. Plague number four. What's happening? God is showing who God is. Pharaoh's learning who God is, little by little. And for the people of God, they're beginning to learn, hey, we might have favor. Because these flies are coming, and they're getting on the Egyptians, but they're not bothering God's people. And darkness is falling over all the land, and it's dark everywhere, except you look over there in the houses where God's people live, and there's lights on. Why? Favor. God was showing them, you got favor. You got favor. God was showing Pharaoh, my people got favor. Got favor. He brought it all the way down to plague number 10. Pharaoh let them go. Pharaoh changed his mind one last time. And he went to get them, and God buried him in the sea. And when that sea was crashing down over Pharaoh and all his army, the sea was saying, God's people got favor. These people, these Egyptians that you've seen today, you will see no more forever. Favor. Next time you get attacked, next time you get down, next time you begin to doubt, next time it seems like the enemy's really pressing hard on you, Go ahead and make room in your pockets and in your closets spiritually, because you're going to come out with more than you went in with. Why? Because you got favor. You need to remember you got favor. And if by chance he did steal something from you, you got enough favor to go back down to the enemy's camp and get it back. Don't ever forget that you have favor. Don't forget it. You can't forget this. You say, "Preacher, how would I ever forget?" Moses was a good leader, great leader. God trusted him with a couple million rebellious, stiff-necked people. And Moses knew, I got to warn the people not to forget. And that's what he did in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 10. He said, "So it shall be, when the Lord your God brings you into the land of which he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob." In other words, it was a reminder. God brought you out to take you somewhere else. How many knows we need to understand that? God gave us favor and brought us out from where we were in order to take us somewhere else. He never intended us for us to stop halfway. He never intended for us to stay close enough to where we were so that we could still go back every now and then. He intended to take us out so that we could go somewhere else that he had prepared for us. And Moses says, when God brings you there, to give you large and beautiful cities which you did not build. That's favor. Houses full of all good things which you did not fill. That's favor. God's people walked into the promised land when they eventually did, and they got houses. They already had flat screens on the wall. Already there. Washer, dryer, they didn't have to get anything. It was already there. That was the favor of God. He said, wells which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees which you did not plant. Now listen to me. He says, when you have eaten and are full. In other words, after you kick your feet back in that lazy boy recliner that they left for you and look at that football game on that flat screen TV that they left for you, do not forget that God showed you favor and brought you out of bondage and to bless you like he did. Do not ever forget it. Don't forget what God brought you out of. You said, "Wait, nobody." Yes, they did. They forgot it. And so do we. Don't ever forget where God brought you from. Don't ever forget the favor that God placed on your life. Do you hear me today? If we could just hear the testimonies today, I could definitely hear somebody stand up and say, I was supposed to go to prison, but the judge decided to give me another chance. It was the favor of God. Don't you forget that. Don't you forget that. Don't you go back to doing your thing. Don't you go back to Egypt. Don't you go back to that which got you in front of the judge in the first place. Remember the favor of the Lord and know that there's more where that came from, and he wants to take you somewhere else. Do you hear me? Somebody might would stand up and say, "I was losing my family, but God somehow brought all the pieces together. I didn't think he could, but he brought us together, and we have love like we've never had before." Don't forget it. Don't forget that. Don't forget that. Somebody could say, I didn't think I'd ever find the right person, but God put the perfect person in my life. You better not forget that. Don't forget the favor of God. Somebody might well stand up and say, "I stared death in the face, but God showed me favor I'm alive today. Do not forget it. Once you have eaten and are full, once you've received the blessings of the Lord, don't forget what God did for you and how He brought you out. Remember His favor. The word of the Lord in Psalm 30 says, His anger is but for a moment. His favor is for life. Job said in 10:12, he said, "You have granted me life and favor." I want you to stand with me and just stand reverently in the presence of the Lord. And no music today. I don't want any music. I just want to talk with you for a minute and pray with you for a minute. Some of you are here today that should not be here today. It was God. You know it was God. There's no other explanation but that it was God. Don't forget the favor. Don't forget the favor that He placed on your life. Don't forget that. Some of you here today, that you're at church every Sunday. You sing. You pray. You give. Do you still know your favor? Do you still know that you are blessed? Do you do what you do out of habit? Or do you do what you do out of the joy and love in your heart for such a good, good Father who loves you? You've got favor on your life. So much favor. Maybe somebody's here today that has never received, never placed their faith in Jesus Christ. Never received that grace, that favor that comes. Perhaps today the Holy Spirit is calling you, drawing you to give your heart to Jesus Christ. While we are here, and I get ready to pray, I just want to ask you to be obedient to the Lord. I think we all could take a moment here as we pray and just help regenerate and renew our knowledge, the revelation of His favor on our life. How we've come through a lot of stuff. He's been faithful. Faithful with His favor toward us. I'm going to pray. God leads you to come, pray in the altars, and I will join you there. I will pray with you. God leads you to pray right where you are. Do that. The Lord is, do you believe the Lord is in this place? He's here. He's here. He's here revealing His favor upon your life. Father, I praise You. I thank You. I thank You for Your favor. God, we are Your people. We are Your sons and Your daughters, and You love us. You gave everything for us. God, sometimes we forget the favor that we have. Sometimes we don't walk in that joy because we forget the favor that's on our life. Lord, I pray specifically for someone today that doesn't know this favor, that doesn't know this grace. And I pray, God, that they would have the boldness, the courage to give their heart to You right now. They would just simply say, "Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me for my sins. I call upon You, Lord, to save me. Save me. Save me. Make me a new person. I trust in Your work. I believe You died on the cross. I believe You rose from the dead. I believe You sent Your Holy Spirit. Fill me with Your Spirit, Lord, right now. Right now. Right now. Thank You, Jesus." God, for that person that is here today, they've been so close to death, so close, but because of Your favor, they're here. Oh, God, right now, just encourage them. But you've got new places for them. You have a new life for them. And I pray that they have the courage and the faith to walk in it. I pray for every family in this church. God, that they know as a family that they have the favor of God on their family. That no weapon formed against them shall prosper. That they are victorious. That they are overcomers. That they are conquerors. I pray this over our children. Our children will grow up and they will serve the Lord. They will serve the Lord. They will be men and women of God. They will do great things in the kingdom of God. They will go further than we've gone. They will accomplish things that we won't accomplish. They will do greater than, because they serve a God that's greater than, just like we do. I give you praise for this, Lord. Let our church realize and know that we have the favor of the Lord on this church. This church has God's favor. You smile down upon your church. You love your bride. You love your body. You love the local church. You love it, God. You gave yourself for your church. Let us see that the church has favor of God. And we're just proud and honored to be a part of it. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. I just want to take a moment just to make sure there's no one here that wants to give their life to Jesus. The Spirit is compelling you to do so, drawing you. If He's drawing you, I want you to be obedient. I want you to come. I want to pray with you. I'm going to wait just a moment, and then we're going to move on. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to be seated, but before you are, I want you to just look at your neighbor and say, I'm favored. So are you. Thank you, Jesus. You can be seated. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm going to welcome Pastor April to come and go over a couple things, but I need to also say a couple things as well. Going to have a baptism service, or excuse me, a baptism on January 31st. It is not on your card to check a box, but if you want to be baptized, I need you to write it on the card. Say, I want to be baptized. Make sure your name is on it. That is on January the 31st. It's only 2 Sundays away. And so we want you to be a part of that baptism. So don't forget that. Also, in your bulletin, there's an insert. And it says, if you are 55 years and older, and you'd like to be part of a senior fellowship day, just they're going to meet, play board games, just fellowship, get to know one another, have a good time. That's going to be maybe one Sunday a month on an afternoon. We just need to see if you're interested. If you're interested in being part of that, just check the box on that survey. Make sure you put the survey in the offering bucket today so that we will know and we can go ahead and establish that. All right? So asking you if you want to participate in that. We've got someone that's interested in heading that up, and we would love to do that. And while I'm saying that, if there's a ministry that you think the church needs to have, and you're willing to head it up, we would love to do it. Sometimes people sit back and say, well, the church needs to do this, and the church needs to do that, but you don't want to be a part of it. Well, how many knows me and Pastor Jay probably got enough things to try to handle, but we want more things happening. And for more things to happen, we need people to say, we'll make it happen. So if there's a ministry, if there's a life group, if you're like, I'd like to do a life group where we go hunting, or a life group that makes quilts, or I don't care, whatever. If you want to do that, that would thrill my heart. That'd thrill my heart, but I don't want to do that. But there may be other people in here that want to do that. And so it can happen if you want to make it happen. So you are the church. Make it happen. Was there anything else that I'd forgotten? I saw Marty's hand go up, so Marty.
I just want to thank everybody for their prayers.
Yes. All right. Praise the Lord.